Now, in this module, we are going to understand the importance of budget, the underlying principles and objectives, and to understand the budgetary process in India. Finance is considered to be the lifeblood of all the monetized socio-economic formations, ranging from the small nuclear families to national and multinational organizations like the governments. Now, the importance of finance today is more than ever before, as it is a scarce resource and it has to be used cautiously, prudently, and judiciously. Moreover, its constant availability has to be ensured so that the major programs of the government and its day-to-day operations do not suffer from the lack of finance. The importance of finance in one's life can be seen from the recent demonetization drive, which has underlined the importance of finance in modern day. Budget is an instrument through which everyone, from small nuclear families to large national and international, organizations like governments try to satisfy the above mentioned and other objectives. In fact, the modern democracies simply cannot function without budget. This is because they have to shoulder a large number of responsibilities ranging from defense, law and order, health, social welfare, etc. Along with that, they have to satisfy the taxpayers that every penny that is taken from them is used prudently, cautiously, and with responsibility for the betterment of their lives and that of the nation. All this is tried to be attained through the instrument of budget. Modern budgeting, however, has changed a lot from its inception. From a mere accountability tool, it has become a tool for guiding the economy, for ensuring the progress of the nation, for shaping the future of the nation and that of its people. As such, budget today is not a document depicting figures of income and expenditure of the government. Rather, it is a document that contains a detailed program of action. Modern budgeting has, however, changed a lot from its inception. From a mere accountability document, it has become an instrument of guiding the economy, of funding the major welfare programs, and even shaping the future of simple households and the nation. As such, budget of today is not a document depicting figures of income and expenditure of the government. It is in fact a document which contains a detailed program and line of action of the government. It is therefore to be prepared very cautiously, taking care of even the minutest details, and has to be examined and passed rigorously and carefully so that there is no wastage of funds and the taxpayers are not unduly taxed. So now the question comes, what the budget actually means. Literally, budget has been derived from the word bugge, which means a pouch in which the British Chancellor of Exchequer used to carry his financial documents. On the whole, the document containing the details of receipts and expenditure came to be known as budget. Different writers have explained the term differently. Some have defined it as a document containing the estimates of income and expenditure, while others have defined it as authorization to incur expenses and to collect revenues. Still others have defined it as the quantitative expression of the proposed line of action. Thereby, it means a document containing the estimates of the income and expenditure of the coming year of the government on the basis of the details of the past. To sum up, we can say that budget is a systematic tool of gathering information from the past and present, of formulating plans for the future on the basis of this, and reporting subsequently how these plans have been carried out. However, one thing we must keep in mind, that the receipts and expenditure are not actual figures, but only estimated values. On the basis of this and other definitions, certain characteristics of budget can be discerned. First of all, budget is always futuristic in nature, that is, it is made for the coming financial year. Then, the figures mentioned in the budget are simply estimates. The actual may differ from them. It is prepared annually. Then it is prepared on behalf of the chief executive. It is a plan framed on the past experience, which is ready for execution. And then it has to be presented before the legislature for its sanction, before it is actually implemented. However, while making budget, one has to keep certain principles in mind so that budget is able to achieve its objectives, to achieve its goals for which it is being made. The first and foremost principle is that the budget should be a balanced one. By this, we mean that the gap between the income and the expenditure should be minimum as far as possible, because if the income is more, then it is called surplus budget, which is not recommended as it creates deflationary tendencies, which results in unemployment as well as rise in prices. While the expenditure is more, then it is called deficit budget, which may lead to inflation and high prices. The second principle which needs to be followed is that the budget should be as comprehensive as possible. That is, the budget should depict the complete health of the government. In other words, it should show in detail the complete performance of the departments and various ministries, so that everyone knows the correct position and do not grudge in paying the taxes. Further, budget should be based on gross income, that is total income, and not the net income, as the net income will undermine the accountability of the executive. Then, budget should be on cash basis, that is, it should show only those figures which are going to be realized during the year. If it is not followed, then there is a possibility that the department may find itself in difficulty. Further, there should be only one budget of the government, as multiple budgets will undermine the simplicity aspect. We should not forget that budget is primarily made for the consumption of the legislature and the common man, both of whom are non-technical people, and multiplicity of budgets will add to their problems and confusions. Related with the above point is the principle of clarity and simplicity. That is, budget should be as clear and simple so that it is understandable. Only then it will serve the purpose for which it has been made. Here, we must know that budget is a document which has been made for the understanding of those to whom the executive is accountable. And so, simplicity becomes very, very essential feature. Last but not least, it should be widely publicized so that it reaches the masses whose lives it is going to affect. Moreover, the citizens are considered to be the rulers in democracy, and so they have every right to know the expenditure of the government. Types of budgets. Budget has a long historical past, and the modern governmental budgeting is the result of long evolutionary process. As such, different types of them have been used depending upon the purpose, need, time, financial position of the government, etc. Some of the main types and are used are as follows. Annual and long-term budget. When the budget is prepared for 1 year, which is generally known as a financial year, it is called annual budget. On the other hand, if it is more than a year, then it is called a long-term budget. The common trend, however, is to make budget on annual basis. Number two, surplus, balanced, and deficit budget. As the term suggests, if the income of the government is shown to be more than its expenditure, then it is called a surplus budget. When the income matches the expenditure, it is called the balanced budget, and when the expenditure exceeds the income, it is called a deficit budget. However, the surplus and deficit budgets are not recommended, as the first one gives a feeling that the government is not doing enough, that is why there is a surplus, and if there is a deficit, then it may lead to inflation and high prices. Third one, cash and revenue budget. If the amount which is shown in the budget is going to be realized in a financial year, then it is called a cash budget. However, if the amount accruing in one financial year shown in the budget may not be realized that year, then it is called a revenue budget. Legislative budget. In this type, the legislature shoulders the responsibility of making the budget. This it does with the help of committees made from amongst its members, passes it, and then gives to the executive for execution. However, it is not suggested that legislature should make a budget because it won't be as realistic as it should be, because it is not the spending authority. Executive budget. When the executive shoulders the responsibility of making the budget, then it is called the executive budget. However, this should not be construed as dominance of the executive. Rather, it should be seen as a step in making budget more realistic, since executive is in a better position to make the estimates. In this type, generally the budget making and the execution is the responsibility of the executive, and it has to obtain the authorization of the legislature before spending it. Line item budget. In this type, all the items and corresponding expenditure are shown in a separate line, and the legislature either approves or disapproves the individual items. Lump sum budgeting. In this type, the executive is given the discretion to not only shift the expenditure from one head to another, but it also is given the freedom to change or shift the amount from one organization to another. Performance budget. Performance budgeting is generally understood as a system of presentation of public expenditure in terms of functions, programs, performance units. Thereby, it reflects primarily the governmental output and its costs. Zero-based budget. This type of budget gained popularity during the regime of Jimmy Carter in the US, who adopted it for all the federal governmental agencies in 1979. The basic idea behind this type of budget is to divide all the programs into packages composed of goals and activities and the requisite resources, and then to calculate individual costs. By starting with the base zero, costs are calculated afresh for every package every year. Budget in India. Coming to Indian budgetary system, Articles 112 to 117 of the Indian Constitution deal with the budget. According to Article 112, the budget in India is called the annual financial statement, which has to be made and passed by the legislature before the end of financial year, that is 31st March. Structure of accounts. There are three funds for all the government transactions. These are known as Consolidated Fund of India, Contingency Fund of India, and Public Account. Consolidated Fund of India. According to Article 266 of Indian Constitution, all the revenues received by the Government of India, all loans raised by that government by issue of treasury bills, loans, or by ways and means of advances, and all monies received by that government in repayment of loan from one consolidated fund, which is called the Consolidated Fund of India. Contingency Fund. Article 267 of the Constitution mentions the Contingency Fund of India. Advances from the fund are made for the purpose of meeting the unforeseen expenditure, which are resumed to the fund to the full extent as soon as the Parliament authorizes additional expenditure. Thus, this fund acts more or less like an imprest account of the Government of India and is held on behalf of the President by the Secretary of Government of India, Ministry of Finance, Department of Economic Affairs. The third account is known as public account, according to which all the public money received by or on behalf of Government of India or the government of a state shall be entitled to public account of India as or the public account of the state as the case may be. Another characteristic of Indian budgetary system is that there are two bills, namely appropriation bill and finance bill, which together make what is known as the budget. According to Article 114, subclause 3, the appropriation bill is intended to give authority to the government to incur expenditure from and out of the Consolidated Fund of India. The procedure of passing this bill is the same as in the case of other money bill. Finance bill, on the other hand, seeks to give effect to the government taxation proposals. The budget of India is made up of two parts, capital and the revenue budget. The capital budget consists of capital receipts and payments such as market loans, borrowings from RBI, loans from foreign governments, etc. The revenue part consists of revenue receipts such as tax and other revenues and expenditure met out of these revenues. Further, the total expenditure is also classified into two parts. One is charged, that is the expenditure which is not subject to vote in the Parliament. These include the constitutional obligations of the government, such as the salary of the constitutional authorities. The other part is known as voted expenditure, which is discussed and put to vote in the Parliament. In India, the financial year starts from 1st April and ends on 31st March. It is a part of the legacy which have been inherited from the British. Another characteristic of Indian budgetary system is the provision of rule of flaps. It is a principle which states that the money which remains unutilized during a financial year should be deposited back in the treasury at the end of the financial year. Another characteristic is the provision of galitone, which is a name given to the process in which the speaker puts all the demands which have not been discussed to vote on the last day of the allotted period to vote. That is, this is a process of passing the demands without discussion. Moreover, another characteristic is that there is a provision of vote on account, which is a method through which the government can get the money in case the budget is not passed by 31st of March. The money which is sanctioned through this process, however, is adjusted when the budget is passed. Vote on credit. It is a money granted by the Lok Sabha for meeting an unexpected demand when, because of the magnitude or indefinite character of the demand, it cannot be stated in definite terms. Budget cycle. The budget cycle in India comprises of three distinct stages, which can be classified as budget preparation, budget enactment, and budget execution. Coming to budget preparation, the budget preparation is basically comprised of 4 to 5 stages, which includes preparation of preliminary estimates by the drawing and disbursing officers, then scrutiny and review by the controlling officers, scrutiny and review by Controller General of Accounts, scrutiny, review and consolidation by Ministry of Finance, and consideration and approval by the Cabinet. Coming to the first step, that is preparation of preliminary estimates by drawing and disbursing officers. It can be said that even though the budget estimates are presented before the legislature in the month of February, yet the process starts sometimes in months of August or September. It is in these months that the budget division of Department of Economic Affairs, Ministry of Finance, sends skeleton forms to the administrative ministries and head of departments for distribution among the drawing and disbursing officers. The main reason for this is the common principle that he who spends the money should also prepare the estimate, as he knows the detail. Along with the skeleton forms, certain directions or guidelines are also sent. This is to ensure uniformity among the filing of estimates. The skeleton forms consists of the following columns, namely the actual of the previous year, budget estimates of current year, revised estimates of the current year, and proposed expenditure of the next year. Generally, there are three forms which are required to be filled. These include standing charges, fluctuating charges, or recurring charges, and new expenditure. The filing of these forms are considered to be the most important aspect in the entire budgetary process, and it is expected that the drawing and disbursing officers will use their all wisdom and expertise and will take all the care and attention for filling up the forms. After the forms are filled up by the drawing and disbursing officers, then it is sent to the controlling officers for their scrutiny and review. The controlling officers are required to collect all the forms related with their department and analyze the relative importance of the proposals and give his remarks in the prescribed column. He has the authority to modify the proposals if he thinks fit. The main point behind their review is to ensure that the estimates are in tune with the policy of the department. He is expected to analyze the estimates, keeping in mind the following points. Assessment of the new schemes in operation must be done before allocating resources. Lump sum provisions for the scheme should be avoided. Only the money to be spent during the coming year should be included. For new schemes, money should be allocated only when all the required approvals have been received. The third step in the preparation is the scrutiny and review by the Controller General of Accounts. After the forms have been scrutinized and reviewed by the controlling officers, then they are sent to the CGA for factual verification and accuracy of the estimates. After the necessary action, the forms are sent to the Ministry of Finance. Ministry of Finance. The budget estimates prepared by the different ministries are received by the Ministry of Finance. One subject of scrutiny and review by it is by taking into account the economic aspects so as to map them within the estimates of revenue of that period. This may result in disputes between the administrative ministry and the Ministry of Finance, which, if not resolved, goes to the cabinet for final solution. The Ministry of Finance generally follows a three-pronged approach for review. There is least scrutiny as far as the fixed charges like pay and allowance. The continuing schemes are subject to scrutiny in relation to their evaluation of performance and progress level reached, and a strict scrutiny is there in respect of new schemes in terms of their importance, need, urgency, and expenditure involved. For the inclusion in the budget, the new schemes require prior approval of Ministry of Finance. By the end of December, the estimates of expenditure are finalized. After that, the Ministry of Finance sits down to make estimate of revenue. This is done in consultation with the Central Board of Direct Taxes and Central Board of Indirect Taxes, and is also assisted by departments of Income Tax, Excise and Customs. At this stage, the Ministry has been empowered to modify or reject the new schemes considering the investment involved. The Finance Ministry completes its scrutiny in the light of availability of funds. The consolidated figures then are sent to the cabinet for its consideration. The last stage in the budget preparation is the consideration and approval of estimates by the cabinet. The cabinet has full right to make any changes in the estimates. It can reject the demands approved by the Ministry of Finance or include the demands which has been rejected by the Ministry of Finance. After the deliberations are over, the Budget Division of Ministry of Finance prepares the final draft of the budget and presents it before the cabinet again for its approval. After the approval, it is divided into two statements, namely demand for grants, which includes the expenditure to be met out of the consolidated fund, and annual financial statement, which shows the total receipts and expenditure of the government, which are ready to be submitted before the Parliament. Budget enactment process. After the budget has been prepared, it is to be presented before the Parliament to get its necessary authorization. The budget enactment process consists of the following main stages, namely presentation to the legislature, general discussion, consideration and passing of the appropriation bill, consideration and passing of the finance bill, budget in Rajya Sabha, and presidential assent. Presentation to the legislature. According to Article 112 of the Indian Constitution, it is the duty of the President to present the budget of the Union Government before both the Houses of the Parliament. It says that he shall lay before both the Houses a statement of estimates of receipts and expenditure of the Government of India, known as the Annual Financial Statement. This statement shows the sums charged on Consolidated Fund of India and sums required to meet the other expenditure. However, in India, there are two budgets which are presented, namely the general and the railway budget. However, the government now has proposed that there will be a single budget of the government. The general budget is presented by Minister of Finance on behalf of the President of India. It is a convention that the presentation of general budget takes place on the last working day of February at 11 a.m. Before presentation, the Minister of Finance makes a customary speech, which is popularly known as the budget speech. This speech is in two parts, namely Part A, which contains the general economic survey, and Part B, which contains the taxation proposals and is known as the finance bill. This bill is introduced soon after the conclusion of the speech of the finance minister. The speech is considered to be important from the citizens' point of view, as it gives an impression about the general economic condition prevailing in the country and the factors affecting our economic environment. It also gives an idea of what actually is contained in the budget. As the time is limited, the minister, along with the budget, also presents certain documents which include the annual financial statement, demand of grants, appropriation bill, finance bill, macroeconomic framework of the year, expenditure budget, etc. General discussion. As per the rules for the conduct of business in the Parliament, no discussion takes place on the day the budget is presented. On a day fixed by the Speaker, which is generally 1 week after the budget has been presented, a general discussion takes place. This is the first discussion on the budget. It is a sort of introduction of the debates and discussions which are going to follow. And as such, the discussion is confined to discussion on the principles or policy underlying the budget. It is confined to the general examination, policy of taxation, etc. To be specific, the members are allowed to make observations about the general scheme of the budget, that is, consideration of revenue surpluses and deficits. They are not allowed to raise any specific grievances. It is considered as an occasion for each house to express its mood. In a nutshell, we can say that no discussion on expenditure is made However, discussion on expenditure charged on a consolidated fund of India can be taken up since it is not subject to vote. Also, the member can take this opportunity to criticize the government. Normally, 2 to 3 days are allocated for this discussion. Demand for grants. This is the next stage in the journey of budget through the parliament, and perhaps the most important one. Although they are called demands, but they are in nature of request by the executive to the Lok Sabha and are related with the expenditure part of the budget. Firstly, it is the voting on grants not chargeable on the consolidated fund of India, which is brought before the House. The demands of grants are brought up ministry-wise, but the finance minister can include in one demand grants proposed for two or more ministries. Voting on demand is the exclusive privilege of the Lok Sabha. It examines the estimates thoroughly and critically before passing. Ordinarily, 2 to 3 days are allocated to a particular demand and 26 days for all of them. Normally, there are 109 demands, out of which 103 are for civil and 6 are for defense expenditure. If the discussion remains incomplete, the demands are passed without discussion on the last day of the budget session. This is known as guillotine. It may, however, be made clear that while the parliament has the power to discuss the demand in detail, yet it cannot increase the amount. It has power only to decrease it through the process of cut motions. The cut motions are used in Indian Parliament and are namely token cut, which is introduced if the mover feels that some part of the demand is excessive. In this case, he moves a motion to reduce a demand by Rs. 100. It is symbolic in nature to vent a specific type of grievance. Economy cut motion. It is moved when the mover feels that the total demand is excessive in nature and thus moves a motion for a specific cut in the total demand of the ministry. Policy cut. This is moved if the member feels that the ministry is not serving any worthwhile purpose and so it should be closed. For this, he moves the motion for reducing the total demand to Rs. 1. This is the most important of all the cut motions, as its passage means that the government will have to resign. However, while introducing a cut motion, the member should ensure that it is related to one demand only and should be expressed in clear terms and should not reflect upon the character of any person and should not make any suggestion for amendment to the existing laws. The cut motions are considered to be very important because it is through them that a discussion on the budget takes place in reality. Otherwise, it has only a symbolic value, as the majority of government does not allow their passage. As a practice, a discussion on the cut motion takes place first, and then the demands are put to vote. The next stage in the budget enactment process is the passing of the appropriation bill. The mere passing of demand does not empower the executive to spend money. Moreover, by the end of the voting, there are number of additions and subtractions in the expenditure side of the budget. So, the government prepares another bill carrying only the voted demands. This bill is known as the appropriation bill and is introduced in the Lok Sabha, and its passing is like any other bill, except that no changes can be made to the bill as all the demands are already discussed and passed by the Lok Sabha. However, Speaker can permit a discussion if he feels that some points were left out previously. In a nutshell, we can say that an Appropriation Act contains the authority given by the Parliament with the assent of the President to the Government of India to withdraw money from the public fund and spend it as authorized in the Act. After it is passed by the Lok Sabha, the Speaker certifies it to be a money bill before sending it to Rajya Sabha, restricting it to make any changes. Consideration and passing of the finance bill. After the passing of the appropriation bill, the discussion on the expenditure side is over. However, the budgetary process remains incomplete as it has to consider ways and means to raise the revenue to meet the past expenditure. In other words, it has to consider the second aspect, namely the income aspect of the budget. This is done by considering and passing the finance bill, which is introduced at the time of presentation of the bill. A finance bill is defined as a bill ordinarily introduced every year to give effect to the financial proposal of the government for the following year, and also includes the bill to give effect to the supplementary financial proposals for any period. Thus, it includes all the taxation proposals, either new or existing. Another feature of the finance bill is that, in contrast to the appropriation bill, sufficient latitude is allowed in the discussion, that is, a criticism of the entire financial policy as well as the general administration is allowed. Another feature of this bill is that Parliament has the power to reduce or reject it, but cannot make any increase. This bill has to be considered and passed by the Parliament and assented to by the President within 75 days after it has been introduced. The next stage in the budget enactment process is budget in the Rajya Sabha. After all the discussion is complete and the budget is voted by the Lok Sabha, it goes to the Rajya Sabha. However, the Rajya Sabha has only limited functions to perform because it has no power either to introduce amendment or rejection. It can only discuss it and return it back to the Lok Sabha within a period of 14 days from the receipt of the bill. If it does not do it, it is assumed that it has been passed by it. The last step in the budget enactment process is the presidential assent. After the budget is passed by the Rajya Sabha, it goes to the president, after whose assent it is ready for execution. The last stage in the budgetary process is the execution of the budget. As far as the execution of budget is concerned, it is in two parts: execution of the expenditure side and execution of the income side. As far as the execution of expenditure side is concerned, it is highly centralized system with Ministry of Finance enjoying a predominant position. It not only dominates the departments in their spending, but overpowers them in a way by giving directions and restrictions in spending their funds. The execution of the budget on the expenditure side includes the following stages, which is generally the opposite of budget preparation stage. Here, the communication is made by the Ministry of Finance to the individual ministries of their voted demands. Then there is a communication by controlling officers to the drawing and disbursing officers, who can start the expenditure by opening accounts with the treasuries. However, for starting expenditure on new schemes, prior approval of Ministry of Finance is required. However, while making the expenditure, the Ministry of Finance ensures that sufficient flexibility is given to the individual ministries, keeping in mind the will of the Parliament. As such, the departments are given the authority to shift expenditure from one minor subhead to another. However, the bills of expenditure are sent on daily basis to both the controlling officers as well as the accounting department to ensure proper control. With regard to the execution of income part, this part of the budget is responsibility of Ministry of Finance, Department of Revenue to be specific. The Department of Revenue exercises this responsibility with the help of Central Board of Direct Taxes and Central Board of Indirect Taxes. The department is expected to ensure that there is proper collection, custody and distribution of funds. As far as the custody of funds are concerned, the Minister of Finance executes this responsibility through the system of treasuries and sub-treasuries and nationalized banks. The main aim here is to prevent embezzlement, misappropriation and ensure convenience and promptness. To conclude, we can say that India possesses one of the most detailed and elaborate budgetary processes. This it has achieved through evolution and innovation. It contains all necessary provisions for proper collection, custody and distribution of funds. It has mechanisms to ensure proper and effective control. Although some changes are required, keeping in mind the changed situation and requirements, but what is most required is the political will. This is because every system operates on certain underlying assumptions, which if not followed, will not give the desired results. The same is true with the budget also. It is assumed that the representatives of the people will exercise all their wisdom in giving authority to use the funds. However, it has been seen that executive, due to its majority in the legislature, gets everything passed and all the mechanisms to ensure effective check on it remain ineffective. So there is a need to effect cost control, physical transparency, realistic preparation of estimates, change of attitude of the Ministry of Finance, timely release of funds to ensure proper spending, keeping check on most of the spending at the end of the financial year. Above all, what is required is propriety, integrity, self-discipline, and high moral standards. Only then budget will achieve the purpose for which it has been made. Thank you.